Good morning, everyone. I'm Bobby Robbins, president of the University of Arizona. So, Kristen, thank you for joining me today. How are you doing?
I'm very busy, but other than that, I'm doing well.
Yeah. So, you know, this has been a real traumatic time for all of our faculty, staff, our students, and really for the world, because this is a devastating global financial and safety problem. So you're the lead on the SAFER program. Can you just tell everyone who's watching this video what the program is, how it prepared our team, including our students, to step up into the role of helping Pima County and all of Southern Arizona?
Sure. So SAFER stands for the Student Aid for Field Epidemiology Response. And we have actually been in existence since about 2005, so about 15 years. The program has been in existence. I started it when I was doing my master's many, many, many years ago. So the team is actually evolved over the years so that our role is to do a couple of things. The first is to do routine surveillance for health departments. Namely, we work with Maricopa County Department of Health doing foodborne infectious disease investigations. And we also work with them to do large special events. So we do things like enhanced surveillance at Super Bowl and NCAA tournaments and other kinds of things. So I actually take students with me and we do public health surveillance there. So what was nice about having this structure already in place is that when COVID-19 cases started to come out, we were able to reach out to the county and say that we had a team that was already trained in place. They already had all the confidentiality agreements and they already knew how to use the state's surveillance system as well, which is how the state has been tracking all of the cases. So we were able to step into that role relatively easily. And start doing those interviews. I think that the biggest challenge for us is that we had to move our entire operation from being on site in a surveillance lab to being virtual, which had a lot of hurdles that we had to get over.
Yeah, no question about it. Everybody has been dramatically affected in the workflow of all the labs and at the university has been affected. You know, our plans are to invite people back for the fall term. We'll be remote for the summer, but we would really love to get people back on campus come late August, early September. And I think there are three sort of guiding principles. I think we have to be incredibly focused on testing, tracing, and isolation. So I think the testing side of things, I feel very comfortable with and confident about that. Although until there's a vaccine, we can't guarantee everyone's safety. We need to stratify people and give good guidance around. I can just imagine Provost Folks and many, many others, including you and everyone that we can get involved in this, is coming up with a reentry plan for campus. But certainly testing, tracing, and isolation are going to be important. On the tracing side, the so-called contact tracing, which actually sounds new to everyone, but you know, when public health was started as a discipline in the early parts of the last century, and certainly by the time the 1917-18 period of the great pandemic occurred, it was basically you find out, well, who have you been around, and you track them all down and you go try, you know, there was no testing then, but just to isolate them. That was the point. So what's your expectation for what we're going to use for contact tracing? I know there's the Google and the Apple app, and you have to opt into it, just like you're having to opt into this testing program that we're doing. But what do you see? Is it just going to be a lot of public health, medicine, nursing, pharmacy students, computer scientists, even that are trained to be these special pandemic detectives, if you will, to actually go and find out, well, who are you around, track them down, contact those people, suggest they get testing, and maybe even isolation. How do you see all of that playing out on the tracking side?
So I think that contact tracing is going to be extremely important to be able to reopen not just the university, but society in general. And so the first piece of contact tracing is the case investigations that my SAFER team is already doing, and along with other people at the health department. So we're just one piece of that bigger puzzle. So when you talk to people, you find out about their risk factors, their symptoms, but you also ask them who they've been in contact with, when they were in contact with them. And the goal is to get their name and phone number in a way that we can actually reach them to find out when they were in contact and if they're having symptoms. So the state has recently just rolled out a new app where people who have been in contact with a known case can then enroll into a system where they can track their own symptoms for 14 days, which allows them to be, one, more cognizant of their own symptoms and illness, and two, just make people aware that if you have been out in society, this is probably a good 2-week time period to get back to your couch or your living room or wherever you've been spending your time. So I think it's a combination of all of those things. And I think what's going to be really important is that people just recognize the fact that this is something new. We haven't had this type of contact tracing that's been done in, you know, in our era of time period. And so I think that we're just going to need people to be patient and need people to be compliant, because that's really the way that we're going to stop the spread, because we know people who are asymptomatic carriers can really contribute to the spread of this infection. And so that's really one of the things that we're trying to mitigate through this contact tracing. And I know it feels a little invasive sometimes, although people tell public health things they wouldn't tell their, you know, their mother, but really it's really important to be able to share that information. And I would also say it's also really important for people who, as soon as they become a known case, to reach out to the people that they have been around, because you can do it faster than public health is going to even get to you. So, you know, in the 5 minutes it would take you, as soon as you know your results, you can let everybody know, versus, you know, the next day or 2 days that it will take public health to contact you. So I would also suggest people to just really think about, who have I been around, and how can I let them know as well that I might be sick?
So there's a technique that you would be familiar with, topological data management, and it looks at nodes and edges. How in the world, when people are riding on the subway in New York City, I just think the epicenter of the world, and the subway system are still running, and you, I test positive, and you say, well, who have you been around? And this gets just sort of some practical guidelines, and I just want to see if I'm kind of in the right zip code on this. But they're going to say, I have no idea who these people are. So I think the guideline would be, anybody you've been within 6 feet of for more than 10 minutes, that's someone that you should report. Either call them yourself or report to the authorities.
Right. So, you know, somebody you walk by in a grocery store for 5 seconds is not going to be somebody that is going to be highly likely to either give you the virus or get the virus from you. And so when we talk about contact, it's exactly as you said, it's that 6 feet or less, really the less, and for 10 to 15 minutes. And so I think that that's something that, you know, most of us have been trying to avoid outside of our household. Absolutely. And so right now, we haven't had to do as much of that. I mean, other than if you're an essential worker, then most of us hopefully have been avoiding that. But I do think that that's important. You know, we're not going to have the ability to follow everybody in the subway and track those people down. But we also don't need to. I mean, this is also important to remember. This isn't measles. So, you know, measles is much, much, much more infectious. And we have to worry about those kinds of things, but we also have a vaccine against measles, which we're very grateful for.
Yes.
So I think that having really getting people to think about who they're having more close contact with. Did you, you know, go to a neighbor's house and then end up sitting and chatting for 30 minutes when you thought you were going to be there for 1 minute to drop something off? Or did you, you know, go and see an elderly family member to bring them food? Or those are the kinds of things that we're really looking for, not so much I walked by a person in the grocery store. And so I think those things are important. And I also think, you know, someone asked me, well, if we can't do that level of tracing, should we even bother? And the answer is absolutely yes, we should bother. Because even if you can't get 100% of the people and 100% of the contacts, every person that you find that's potentially exposed and potentially transmissible to others, infectious, then you absolutely, even finding those smaller portion of people, as you know, it's the kind of exponential curve, right? As you have more people, if you can cut off several of those nodes, then it cuts off everything that's downstream of those nodes. And that's why it's so important. Even if we can't be 100% effective every single case in contact, being able to do it effectively will dramatically decrease the transmission in our community.
Well, that's all really good information. This is why I have no idea what's really going to happen, but I generally am out over my skis a little bit too far, but predicting that, I just can't see we're going to bring people, 40,000 people together in a football stadium by September. It's going to be tough. I think until there's a vaccine, we're going to have to really be in sort of a semi mode of operation that we're in right now. But I do believe with testing, tracing, and isolation that we can manage a university campus, but it's going to take all of us, and we're going to have to be very disciplined and very strict on how we enforce these things.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, it would be great if, you know, UV killed everything. But a lot of times, well, one, you know, we live in a pretty sunny climate. So it's not like it wasn't sunny in February here. Right. So UV is not going to do everything. And I think the issue with heat, a lot of times when we associate flu and, you know, part of that's the virus itself, but part of it's just that people are out and they're not commingling and inside as much. So I think, you know, there's a chance we can see some decrease, but I absolutely agree with you that we're probably very likely to see an increase in the fall. And unfortunately, that's going to be the time when we're also seeing flu ramp up. So I think the other really important message to get out to people is to get your flu vaccine. I think that this has been a, public health has been beating the vaccine drum for a very long time. And I saw something online and it said, if you want a world with no vaccines, this is a world without one vaccine. So it's really good messaging that how important vaccines are and how we really rely on them to have a functioning society. And so having people get their flu vaccines starting in, you know, August, September, October is going to be extremely important, because that's going to reduce that burden to the public, to the medical profession, because people get sick from the flu every year and end up in emergency rooms and in the hospital. So if we can decrease the burden on hospitals for flu, then it will be that as cases of COVID start to increase, then we won't have such an impact to our healthcare system.
It's unfair for you to be predicting, but if you were thinking, you know, I've been listening. Peter Hotez is a good friend of mine down at Baylor, and he keeps making the point: the fastest a vaccine has ever been developed is 3 years. So the thought that we're going to put this big Manhattan project together, and it really is a global collaborative project that not only are universities and research institutions, but also the public sector and or the private sector, companies like Johnson & Johnson and others are on this race to develop this vaccine. What's your best guess of when we would have a vaccine, and when when we do have an effective one, and I know there are some phase three studies that are going on at Oxford and other places, but we've got to remember, once we say, okay, we're good to go on the vaccine, we still got to manufacture at least 300, probably 600 million doses for the U.S. so that everybody probably will need a booster or a second dose. We've got to manufacture it, we've got to distribute it, and then we've got to administer it. So what in your thought, you know, if you're predicting with a crystal ball, which none of us have, what do you think the realistic idea of a vaccine coming in the next 1, 2, 3 years is?
Well, I guess my hopeful side would say, you know, under 2 years. And yep. And I think that part of it's because, you know, while we haven't developed a vaccine in that speed before, we also haven't had the technology to do it up until this point. So I think yep. that, you know, we had the gene for this virus sequenced before it was, you know, we even really knew that this was going to happen. So right. I do think that we have some advantages today than we would have had, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago. But that being said, I think you bring up a really good point. You have, you know, we don't want to move too fast because there is a chance that, you know, if you do something wrong, you could, you know, you could have the consequences could be dire. And so making sure that we have a safe vaccine, then dealing with the manufacturing, which we don't, you know, we don't have on very large scale in this country. Most of our vaccines are manufactured outside of the country. And so, but not only for people here, but we need vaccines for the whole world. And then on top of that, as you said, we have all of the distribution and administration. So thankfully, we've been working on the distribution and administration. I mean, the university has our own, we have a mass vaccine plan that I've been part of for years. We have points of dispensing plans that I've been working on with Brian Seastone and others for years. So I think that we have a good plan in place, but we still actually need the vaccine to be able to do it. And then figuring out also how we do it. Do we do it in tiers? Do we do the most vulnerable first? How do we make those decisions? So there's a lot of really important decisions coming up around vaccine. But I think, you know, I think 2021 is going to be not the best year for us. It's not going to be as Great. Bad as this one. But I really do think it's possible that we're not going to have, you know, the vast majority of people vaccinated until the end of 2021 because of just all of the logistics that you mentioned. And I would love to be wrong on this. I would love to, you know, that'd be great. But I think, you know, this is a situation where a lot of epidemiologists are saying, you know, here's all the 10 reasons that things are bad, but we would love to be wrong on those. This is the one situation where I'd love to be proven wrong. But but I think we, you know, I've worked in the area of kind of pandemic preparedness for many, 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 many years. And, you know, everything's pretty much playing out the way that we anticipated, right. just a lot faster, I think.
Yeah. Well, I thank you very much. Today, I've been joined by Dr. Kristen Pogreba-Brown, Assistant Professor in the Epidemiology and Biostatistics Department at the Mel and Enid Zuckerman College of Public Health right here at the University of Arizona. She got her master's and PhD here at the University of Arizona, and she leads this team, the SAFER program here at the university. Kristen, thank you so much. The one thing that's been a silver lining about this is I've gotten to spend more quality face-to-face time with more people at the university than I have done in the recent past. And you're truly an incredible treasure and asset to the university. So thank you for all of your leadership, all the hard work you're doing and your team's work during this difficult time. So thank you again for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
So next time I'll have another incredible superstar from the University of Arizona to join us to talk about the future, which I think is bright. We're all going to get through this, but as Kristen has been outlining in such a detailed and expert way, we've got to be patient, we've got to be vigilant, we've got to test, we've got to trace, and we've got to isolate. So until then, follow the guidelines until we tell you the coast is clear. And as always, bear down.